Hello, my name is Guilel Treiber, and I'm a researcher at the Research Center for Political Philosophy and Ethics at the Institute of Philosophy of the Leuven University in Belgium. I specialize in theories of power, resistance, in contemporary continental philosophy. Presenting theories of power is a daunting challenge, since one can convincingly argue that power has been the central concept of political philosophy since its beginning in the Athenian slave-owning republic of the 5th century BCE. Trying to present this long history will be impossible within the space allotted to each presenter. It may also be unnecessary, since power is the most ubiquitous of concepts, a byword for everything from violence and war to empowerment and freedom. We all think we know what power means, and perhaps even what it should mean. Given that the shadows of war are rising over a Western world that believed it was immune to war for decades, it seems that power can be reduced quickly to the sum of military might one can deploy. Is this so? If power were reducible to physical strength, of which tanks, guns, and nuclear weapons are extensions, then our world would be one where might is right. The law of Jupiter would entitle the powerful to do and take whatever they like, whenever they like, ignoring the power of customs, laws, values, and the underestimated power of collective or individual self-defense. Indeed, even the relatively self-evident example of war shows how power is a contested term. It is contested both in its meaning and its application. It is, for example, evident that the Russian president had the power to invade and that Russia's means of war will prevent other nations from intervening immediately. However, as events made clear, the power of the Ukrainians is considerable, as is the soft power of Western economic institutions. Though Russia has more military power than Ukraine, it has not the power to complete its declared aim of controlling the country. Though Ukraine is weaker to some extent, it uses the power of other nations to provide material help and armaments. Moreover, there is a global power balance at stake between NATO, China, and Russia. There is the power of information, disinformation, social media, NGOs, humanitarian help, and armed resistance. In this case, as in many other more mundane cases, power seems to be everywhere. And as the common saying goes, if it is everywhere, it is nowhere. In the case of power, we'll see that this statement has significant consequences. Furthermore, the above clarified that, much as philosopher Anna Arendt stated in the 1970s, violence and power should not be conflated. Though related, power has a political, collective, constructive aim, while violence is usually a destructive force. A good way to keep our head clear and our road in view is to divide the following presentation into a few classical WH questions. What is power? Who has it and who does not? Where is power and how is power operated? Or in other words, how is power powerful? As a philosopher, I do not aim to answer these questions exhaustively, but to deepen the exploration, to show that the ubiquity of power is its root, and that power is most powerful when we do not know it, when we ask no questions about it. Hence, by definition, every question on the nature of power, on its practice and its holders, contributes to making power more visible, more understandable, and at the end of the day, or at least I hope so, more accountable. What is power? As the book of Genesis clarifies, in the beginning, there was power. And for a long time, power was understood to be precisely the power of God to create ex nihilo, out of nothing. Divine power was the essence of power, and those wielding power were doing it by extension of that one power. Indeed, the father was understood to be the creator of his children, and hence held absolute authority over them. Before becoming a concept denoting an action to limit and shape the good of another without their complete agreement, the term paternalism referred to the Roman pater familias, who infamously had the power to execute his own children. When Niccolo Machiavelli published The Prince in 1513, he shifted the focus away from the divine. For him, it was personal characteristics that made a man mighty and prince-like. A prince could wield power only if he were man enough. And this gender aspect of power plagued our understanding for millennia. If he were manly and had enough virtues of the kind Machiavelli thought were necessary, such as courage, audacity, decisiveness, and charisma, he would be able to rule, achieve great things, and mark history for all times. Glory, basically, was a proof of your power. About 100 years later, Thomas Hobbes shifted the debate again by enlarging the scope of power, by arguing every individual has equal power to everyone else. Left to their own devices, human wanting to force others to their bidding or defend their interests will reach a state of war of all against all. According to Hobbes, the threat of an all-out chaotic war is so great that individuals eventually give away their powers to an external authority, the state. Given that the state will amass all this power divided between many, Hobbes termed it a leviathan, a biblical monster. In a weird turn of events, by the end of the 19th century, Friedrich Nietzsche argued in The Genealogy of Morals that power is the power to create, but that this power is not divine at all. Instead, it is the power of some to create values. It is the power of values that shape our history, and that the history of our morality is that which regulates our everyday lives. And of course, regulation is a form of power, since it is the power to make and enforce rules of conduct. Today, such historical attempts to define power in its essence are inadequate in coming to terms with the plurality of experiences we have of power. Therefore, power is usually understood as a byword for a family of concepts. We will rarely speak today of power with a capital P, but of power together with strength or force when we refer to its physical qualities. We will speak of political power and use domination, authority, coercion, and violence to emphasize its more hierarchical, primarily negative characteristics. We will speak of influence, manipulation, or rhetoric regarding its symbolic sway over people. And in a democratic context, we will usually speak of power as the autonomy to do certain things. In terms of legitimacy, when someone has power over another, as compliance when someone follows the demand of legitimate power. One last crucial way of speaking nowadays of power is as a constitutive element of our social reality. Power makes us who we are and shapes the world we experience in deep and meaningful ways. Especially the last notion of power shows that speaking of children and childhood cannot advance very far without speaking of power. Indeed, the term child itself, with its immediate ability to tag an individual human being as being less than others in terms of responsibility, for example, and more in other terms, for example, in a perceived right to life, is imbued with power. Defining human beings as children is far beyond a neutral action based on objective qualities such as age, size, or mental abilities. Being a child means being limited in power, physical or intellectual, and by power, legal authority. It sometimes means being exposed to domination and abuse more than others. Hence, when we come to talk of children, the question of what is power, or what power are we talking about when we are talking of children, is by and large implicit, unasked, unanswered, and hence, as I've stated earlier, urgently needs to be addressed. Who has power and who does not have it? In an influential contemporary definition of power, Stephen Lux argued that power has at least three dimensions in his book, Power, A Radical View. In the classical one-dimensional sense, power is about who can decide, and in a democratic context, who can make a public decision tilt in this or that way. In this one-dimensional understanding of power, power is about an observable conflict concerning decision-making within a context shaped by different interests. Let us take for, as an example, the debate in an imagined community on whether to allow a denominational school to open. The decision is conflictual, in this case, since different interest groups are at play. We can observe the conflict and follow the behavior of individual agents. In the end, a decision will be taken, contenting some and alienating others. The assumption is that those ablest to influence the final decision are more powerful than others. The two-dimensional understanding of power is that power is not only about which decision is taken, but also about those decisions that are not taken. Let us return to our imagined community, where opening a denominational school is debated. The debate may have attracted media attention and many vocal supporters and opponents. Still, it may have been used to divert attention from the issue that, in this fictional community, denominational schools are cheaper than public schools. The conflict we observe here, the one concerning opening or not a denominational school, is hiding a covert conflict between the adherents of free public education financed by the state and those who prefer the poor to have only religious schooling because, in this community, religion teaches submission and obedience to temporal authorities. In this respect, the instance or individual preventing this latter discussion from emerging, making it a non-decision, is the most powerful. Power here is understood again as the power to influence not only decisions, but also to prevent certain decisions from being taken. The three-dimensional concept of power complicates things in significant ways. It leads us away from an actual decision taken or not taken and into the possible decisions that should have been taken. The concept is formulated against the two concepts mentioned above. It rejects the rationalistic bias of the two in favor of a focus on social forces and institutional practices. These prevents the objective interests of those excluded from decision-making procedures from coming into conflict with the interests of the dominant. For Lukes, conflict is always a potential in a three-dimensional understanding of power. In other words, the conflict should be there, but it is not for some elusive reason. Indeed, it is prevented from coming into actual existence by what neo-Marxists like Louis Althusser or Antonio Gramsci called ideology or hegemony, respectively. In other words, the power of knowledge and the power of culture. Let us go back to our example. The denominational school at the heart of much debate in our imagined community. According to the three-dimensional concept of power, we can say that we must wonder why the conflict is not concerning religion itself. The argument will go along the lines of the poor cannot see that religion is not their refuge, but their prison. It prevents them from seeing that they are being exploited for their workforce and that religion is used to distract them from what is going on behind the veil of ideology. I have introduced these two terms, ideology and hegemony, without explaining them properly. Let us say rather plainly that ideology is the idea that the power of our socioeconomic structures distort our system of knowledge. The distortion is such that without a proper emancipatory and emancipated critical theory, we'll not be able to grasp these structures and the nature of our subjugation fully. Hegemony, like ideology, extend the scope of the socioeconomic power, but this time into the field of culture and intellectual production. According to those using the concept, power is not only located in the political institutions, such as its executive or legislative branches. In a given society, the power structure is supported by an entire array of cultural and intellectual productions and institutions, schools being one prime example. Reinforcing the given state of things of, for example, economic exploitation or racial segregation. And indeed, Ideology and hegemony complicate things not only because they enlarge the scope of power to spheres of life we may have thought untouched by it, but they also turn the question of power towards the one asking them. They force us to wonder if the right question concerning power is asked at all, and if so, by whom and why, and with what interests and motives. They introduce a suspicion that even the basic facts of our lives are not to be trusted because they may represent a political or other power agenda that is turned against us. In so doing, they damage what no political system can survive without: trust. Moreover, both ideology and hegemony give the theorist a power they did not previously own, the epistemological power to know the real world in its objective, truthful existence, and the emancipatory power to communicate this real world to those exploited. The theorist must clear the fumes of what Marxists called for a time false consciousness. So indeed, ideology and hegemony demand those exploited to trust not those holding political power, but those who manipulate words and thought, writers and thinkers who hold symbolic power. And since no power can be maintained for a long time without trust or stability, we must wonder why the theorist demands it. With ideology and hegemony, we have stepped into a circular maze of suspicion from which it seems only the powerful will profit. Where is power? The concept of ideology from Marx to Althusser and his students, and the concept of hegemony formulated by Antonio Gramsci, lead us quite naturally to the question of where power is. If we are to seize power, to redistribute it more fairly, or take it to reshape society radically from the base up, we need to know where it is located and how to get there. In many occurrences, the place of power is symbolic. Power may reside in presidential palaces that the masses want to attack, or in squares and financial districts that the crowd want to occupy. Power may even reside in the parental bedroom or be epitomized by the car keys. Holding such symbols may even make us feel more powerful and in control. It even will allow other people to recognize that we are more powerful and in control. When we do this, we implicitly assume that power is an object to hold, a property to own, something to exchange, trade, or take by force. And it is undeniable that power has symbols and concrete locations through which it operates. In the Western world, the cross and the scepter were for a long time objects of religious and temporal power, adorned in wealth and magnificence, worshipped in cathedrals and palaces. They were there to impress the senses and make us forget that behind them were concrete individuals made of flesh and bone, sinew and blood, who were fallible and selfish. The history of their abuses can be as long as the history of the struggles against them. In the end, democratic power, the power of the people, drove them away from their places of power, leaving it all but empty. Claude Lefort, a French theorist, claimed that precisely this emptiness characterizes democratic power. While in monarchies, the place of power is occupied by a representable, concrete, individual body, that of the king or queen, in democracy, no such representable body can occupy the place of power. It is, by definition, empty, and to an extent should remain empty if we want to remain democratic. According to Lefort, the collective agents of democracy, whether the nation or the people, can never be fully represented by an individual or even a party. Instead, they can be captured in abstract symbols, such as the constitution or the flag. When in a democracy, a person thinks that they are the people, that they can embody it, democracy is imperiled. We can apply such a theory to the modern post-patriarchal family with some adjustment. Imagine a family of two parents and three children. Where does power reside in their group? Is the parents embodying it? Is it located in their bedroom or the kitchen? Or can the children, with a simple majority and a few compromises between themselves, turn the tide on bedtimes and homework? In such a theory, the family looks like a contested space where no one can fully hold or occupy the space of power indefinitely. Now to our last WH question, how is power operated? The three questions we addressed, what is power, who holds it, and where does it reside, all depend on the answer we give to the question of how power is operated. Indeed, if we understand power as an object, it is understandable that we want to redistribute it, divide it, and perhaps get more of it. Likewise, if we talk of power as a characteristic of gender, race, or a people, it is perhaps understandable why we may be reluctant to include others in our group. Hence, it is crucial to understand not only who holds power and where, but also how, by being operated, one becomes powerful. Again, a French theorist, Michel Foucault, addressed these issues most insistently. Foucault argued that power is a relational thing. It exists as the result of a relationship between agents broadly construed, where each side shapes to an extent the actions of the other. Much like a game, power appears when one can play with the actual and potential actions of the other. Indeed, to an extent, Lux and Foucault share many points, yet there is one significant difference between the two. Foucault does not attach importance to the theorist as the one who is responsible for showing the real world to its agents. For Foucault, people are not quite able to understand their real interests, but also power processes are mostly hidden in plain sight. We just need to look with the right lenses. If anything, the theorist, Foucault included, is part and parcel of a system that produces and shapes our world. The power most difficult to challenge is such a constitutive power that structures the norms that divide our world into good and evil, normal and abnormal, reasonable and unreasonable, healthy and sick, male and female, and indeed, adult and child. These rationalities of power give meaning as they divide. To reduce their more nefarious effects, exclusion, for example, we must problematize them and render them visible for what they are: arbitrary products of past victories over one group over another. Following Nietzsche, Foucault thinks that the most insidious forms of power are those that hide their story of brute strength and violence by sublimating it under terms such as justice and progress. When shown in their arbitrariness through historical reconstruction, these forms of power can be changed, transformed, or eluded. The most dangerous form of power, according to Foucault, is the power that seems to come from nowhere, the power that presents itself as the natural result of given predetermined processes. It is, for example, the idea that we can be free of power and excesses. Indeed, the idea that we can make our chaotic, plural, diverse world freer by making it more unitary and manageable through reason, transparency, equality, and to some extent even inclusivity, is for Foucault perilous. It can render power structures opaque and make them work better by controlling, disciplining, and reducing the plurality of forms of existence, by the sublimating effects of art and culture, and by a tolerant, caring society. A completely ordered, tolerant society, intolerant of all intolerances, is one of the more dangerous possibilities out there for Foucault. Let us conclude. The impact of Foucault's insights is still felt in analysis of power in the social sciences and the humanities, from historical research to the study of education. Feminist, postcolonial, or queer theories owe much of their best formulations to Foucauldian sensitivities. As these bodies of theory do, one must wonder how systems of exclusion and subjugation have excluded masses of people from any power and maintained themselves for generations. There are usually two families of answers to this line of questioning. The first one, more conservative, by distancing oneself from feminism, post-colonial or queer theories, a first family of answers undermine the historical accounts of the violence of exclusion by arguing, for example, that power may have been softer or the victims have actively contributed to their subjugation. The other family of answers, located usually within feminist, post-colonial and queer theorizing, states that something concerning the justification itself of subjugation was so utterly convincing that even those on the other side of the gun barrel did not question the legitimacy of those wielding the gun. And indeed, reason and nature are still two of the most dangerous forms of justifying the excesses of power in our world. Lack of reason, or the subjugated nature of an individual, are perhaps less explicitly stated than in the 18th century or before, yet they are still the main justifications used to prevent access to power from certain people. That one is a child, for example, or unfit to think. That one is too sick or too old or too frail to make decisions. That one is suffering from too many pathologies to listen to their admonitions. All of these are present in medicine, psychology, education, and penal theory, and are still used every day to take power away and to shape the actions of others in a meaningful way. To wrap up, let us go quickly about what was stated. Power is not brute violence and cannot be understood as such. It is so often used that it is better to understand power as a family of concepts instead of a unitary concept with one clear definition. When asking who has power, we've discussed the three dimensions of Luke's concept of power, explaining in the process the importance of ideology and hegemony developed respectively by Althusser and Gramsci. Concerning the space of power, we've shown that it can reside in concrete individuals, but today in a democratic context, it resides mostly in symbols, such as the flag or the constitution of a nation. We've also reflected with Foucault about the constitutive aspects of power, and specifically the ability to create distinctions between the normal and the abnormal, between reason and madness, healthy and sick, or adult and child. We finished by mentioning the crucial, insightful contribution to the study of power by feminist queer and post-colonial theorists. Thank you for watching.